Amazing. Okay. So yeah, welcome everyone who is joining us. My name is Meg. My pronouns are she, her, and I am our community marketing manager at Arteryx here in British Columbia. I just wanted to acknowledge that I am on the unceded land of the Squamish, Musqueam, and Tsleil-Waututh Nation. And I'm super glad that you're all here to join us today. Just a quick run of show for the evening. I'll be your host tonight, so I'll be chatting with everyone and making sure the flow is all good. And I'm going to intro our three panelists that are joining us tonight. So I'll start with Kate Stewart. She's from Canadian Adaptive Climbing, so she'll give an intro on their program and organization. And then I will lead into Georgina and Noreen, who are our awesome adaptive climbers and wonderful women that are going to share a lot about their journey with climbing. We'll have a quick discussion just about their experience with climbing and how they've kind of grown with the process of learning more. And then we will end with a Q&A. So if anyone has questions throughout, feel free to pop them in the Q&A tab. It should be at the bottom. We'll see them pop up on the right-hand side, and then I can direct them to the right folks at the end. And then, yeah, we'll be good for the evening. I think we should probably be around 30 or 40 minutes, so we appreciate you taking this time out. I know with summer nights, it's tempting to be outside, so we really appreciate that. So, I will pass it off to Kate Stewart, who is an executive director with the Canadian Adaptive Climbing Society and super passionate about climbing and helping adaptive athletes all across Canada. So I will let her do her intro.
Amazing. Thanks so much, Meg. I am off mute. Good. Again, thanks so much for that introduction. To briefly introduce the Canadian Adaptive Climbing Society, we create opportunities for individuals living with barriers to benefit from climbing. So essentially, we use equipment, techniques, volunteers, et cetera, to make climbing accessible for everyone. And often this means creating first climbing experiences for individuals who may have different needs than a standard rock climbing gym is equipped for, but also creating community for return climbers and just generally making climbing accessible both indoors and outdoors for everyone and anybody who wants to access climbing. So I look forward to hearing from Georgina and Noreen about their experiences with CACS and climbing in general. They both have very good insights, and I'm excited for the panel discussion. Oh, you're on mute.
I said amazing. We're happy that you're here. Thank you. Next, I'm going to introduce the two lovely ladies on the screen as well. It's Georgina and Noreen. So first, Georgina is based in Coquitlam and had started climbing in 2017. Definitely told me that the experience started as a little test and has grown into a passion for Georgina, along with hand cycling and downhill skiing, which she's told me some pretty awesome stories about. And then when she isn't climbing, you can find her in her role as a health and safety director at work, so advocating for health and safety at workplaces. And last but not least is Noreen. Noreen was first introduced to climbing through spinal cord injury BC, and was afraid of heights at the start, had the typical kind of fear about joining climbing and on all the things that go into trusting other people when they're belaying you on the wall. But after a few programs with Canadian Adaptive Climbing, she was hooked and has been both on indoor and outdoor climbs. And Noreen is also a mom of three and loves adaptive sailing as well. So those are the two lovely ladies that are joining us. Brief intros, there's definitely much more to learn about them. But first question we're going to dive into is to have you two tell us about your first experience with climbing and where it was, why you went, and what inspired you to get involved. So Georgina, why don't you start us off?
Sure. So I started climbing in the spring of 2017, and it was in response to a notice that came up with Spinal Cord Injury BC saying that there would be this this opportunity to try climbing out. And I've had friends and family that have climbed in the past and really enjoyed it. And we had spent a lot of time pondering whether it could be adapted or not, but hadn't come across anyone who tried it out. And here was this chance. So I went out to the Richmond Climbing Wall and also had to overcome a fear of heights and tried out the first set of equipment. And when we were done that night, we had long discussions about how to adapt things, try again. And that started on this long journey that we've been on ever since, experimenting with different equipment and getting better and better every time on how to attack a wall or a space outdoors as well.
Amazing. Yeah, I think one of the great things that you told me is every time you climb, it's an evolution to the program, which I think is so wonderful and kind of makes the process better for volunteers and everyone included. So that's so great. Noreen, let us know about your first dip in the waters.
Yeah. Well, my first one was like at UBC, The Nest, like they have a wall there. And SEIBC introduced me. And that's when I met Brent Goodman. And they are very encouraging. Like, you know, people inspired me, like people like Georgina, because I am a walking injured, which is I am an incomplete spinal cord injury, which is I look fine from the outside, but I have issues. So, the first try I had was like very difficult because I was so scared. I didn't even finish the climb the wall. Like the wall was like only tiny. And I was like so scared halfway through. Like I said, I need to get down now. And then I tried a few times, and that's when I learned to trust my belayer, because she was really really good and encouraged me. And like, she tells me, like, you know, if you need to rest, then you can rest, and you don't have to force like yourself to keep going. Like, you know, you could stop and wait. And so that was like the experience I had with them. And I was invited also to go to climb outdoors, so it was an amazing experience, and I loved it after that.
You're hooked.
Yes.
Yeah, I think you touched on a really great point about the trust between belayers and the team that you're on. I think people see climbing sort of as a solo sport because so many people that, you know, get attention and kudos, it's that one person on a wall. But I think it's a great segue too into our next topic about trust and partners are so important in climbing. And I'm curious what that looks like for the both of you and, you know, what evolution has teamwork had in your role in adaptive climbing? Noreen, do you want to kick us off with this one?
Okay. Well, actually, like, you know, teamwork is very important, and also trust, because you're entrusting your safety to your belayer. And I'm always scared that, like, you know, if I fall and then I'm gonna hurt myself even more. So I thought, like, you know, geez, this is so difficult. Like, how am I gonna do this? And so Jess was my first belayer, and whom I learned to trust after a few times. And even when we went outdoors, she belayed me. And so it was like you have to communicate and also, learn to listen sometimes, because they kind of point you to the direction where, like, because I am inexperienced and I don't really know much about climbing. So they kind of like tell you, oh, maybe try this or try that. And so I kind of learn how to maneuver myself. Like it's hard because I have weak arms and legs. But then they encourage you and, like, you know, very supportive. And like, you know, they don't judge you for what you do on the wall. So yeah, it's very encouraging, and like I think it's a big leap for me to kind of like, you know, learn how to conquer my fear.
Yeah, that's pretty special when, you know, someone, whether it's a stranger or a new friend, can kind of help you get to that point. So Georgina, let us know on from your end.
So I had a bit of experience with learning how to quickly trust a team from skiing. So when I ski, I ski in a bi-ski, and I have a tethered person behind me assisting because I don't have the arm strength to do it completely on my own. So learning how to come down a ski hill in tandem with someone helped with the climbing teamwork process. And for me, there are other components to it, like going outdoors actually requires friends and family to help me get to the location. And I remember one of our outdoor locations that we went to was really fantastic when we got to the rock face, but getting to the rock face required three people to lift me up in my wheelchair and carry wheelchair and me along this trail that really wasn't wide enough for what we were trying to accomplish. So so those kinds of things come into play, as well as just having a number of people help with everything from getting equipment on and off. And I use a counterweight system, which in the first, no, it continues to be a little unnerving, I have to say. When people switch around or when it's time to come down, the counterbalance system gets unweighted, and there's this momentary second or two where you really feel all of that kind of come down, and you feel like you're dropping. You're not really, but it took a long time to kind of trust that process as well. But we have a really great community within the Vancouver climbing group, and lots of strong kind of friendships around the climbing process have been built up over the years, and it's been a great journey, really.
Oh, so well said. Yeah, I've seen a lot of photos from your sessions in Vancouver, and I recognize a lot of the same faces. So it definitely seems like a pretty committed crew of people. And yeah, I appreciate you bringing up just the accessibility piece. I see that so much in community programming. Accessibility, like getting to and from events or to and from programs, is such an important call out. So I appreciate you bringing that up. I'm curious next about just what about climbing. I always ask people this when they enter something new, and I can speak for myself. I'm still dabbling in the new world of skiing. As a girl from Alberta, people can't believe that I didn't ski, but it's true. And I always like asking people, like, what surprised you about a new activity, or what was unexpected when you entered the world of climbing? Like, what became your biggest surprise? Georgina, do you want to kick it off? We're going to popcorn back and forth.
I think the biggest surprise really was just learning how much I could do on my own. So once we had the equipment really well set up and had figured out the counterbalance system and things like that, there was a lot of opportunity to explore kind of how I could move on an indoor climbing wall on my own. And that was something that really helped with me continuing on, because I wanted to be able to continue in a sport where I could do as much of it on my own as I could. And this turned out to be one of those. And so getting to the top of a climbing wall or to the top of a kind of a rock face that we were climbing outdoors had that real neat sense of accomplishment because of what I could manage and do on my own.
Yeah, nothing beats that feeling of getting to the top. Noreen, what surprised you about climbing?
Well, what surprised me is because I never thought I could do anything after my injury. Like, you know, basically my life was, I go to rehab and then home, and I was totally getting depressed, so what happened was, like, my physiotherapist encouraged me to join a group. So I kind of find SCIBC, and I think I fit in that group. And what happened, like, you know, they introduced me to climbing, which is like, I never thought I could do anything else other than, like, you know, just get better. And that's all I did when I was after my injury in 2016. So like, you know, climbing is, I never thought it's something that I'd be able to do. And yeah, so it's surprising for me that I'm able to climb indoor and outdoor. Like, I know indoor is a little easier because there's so many things that you can grab on, but outdoor, yeah, that's a challenge. But, like, you know, that's surprising, which is, like, you know, you feel amazing after you kind of, like, accomplished something. Yeah,
totally. I like the call out too of how different indoor and outdoor is, which I think for everyone, Georgina and Noreen have both done outdoor and indoor climbing, which I think is pretty amazing. And we're very lucky in Vancouver to have accessibility to so many outdoor and indoor opportunities. So I'm curious what you both love about indoor and outdoor climbing, or maybe what you don't love, but I'm curious, yeah, just to hear the difference between the two. Georgina?
I like the indoor the most, I have to say. There's lots of opportunity to kind of explore different ways of moving, because there's different handholds and different footholds and things to try. The outdoor experience was definitely fun, and some of the places that we went to and climbed at are places I would never have gotten to without climbing, without the team, without the equipment. Those are just not venues you travel to with a power wheelchair. So those were my takeaways from the outdoor, and the indoor is something that I like to pursue because a recreational activity that I can do with a group on a regular basis, and I can do it in all seasons. And so those things are important to me as well, while we're kind of skill building and doing those things.
Yeah, that's great. Noreen, what about you?
Indoor is something that I could strengthen, like, you know, when you climb indoor, like, everything is laid out, and you just have to maneuver from rocks to rocks. So you could, like, you know, say the indoor, like, you know, you could strengthen your arms and your legs, your grip, because everything is there for you to. It's a good practice for me to do that. And so it's a good start for me. And then when I kind of transition to outdoor, which is sometimes you're kind of like, what do I do here? Like, you know, there's hardly anything. Like, basically, when you look at the rock, it's like, oh my God, how am I gonna do this? Because there's nothing to hold on to. Like, you know, it's not like the indoor one, but you know, you just kind of learn the way how to get through the rocks. But it's amazing when you get up to the top, because, like, the view is, it's beautiful. Like, you know, when we went to White Cliff and we climbed the wall, and it was really amazing to see the view from the top. And yeah, it's much difficult. Like, you know, I had a hard time, but it's a good practice from indoor to outdoor. You know, you learn from that, and then you kind of, like, you know, maneuver from there. So I love mostly, I love outdoor because of the, like, the air and the environment and the view. Yeah, that's the most I love. Yeah.
Yeah, it's that feeling like you're the only one seeing the view is pretty a special feeling. I know that.
Yeah.
You call out for, like, being outside and connecting is, you know, kind of the the difference you feel of being outside. We have a campaign and a saying at Arteryx. It's called Outer Peace, which is our little play on, you know, getting outside and finding peace with being, you know, away from screens and desks. And yeah, I'm curious what each of you do. We touched on it a little bit in your intros, but I'm curious what other activities that you both love to do, and how do you find outer peace? Let's go, Noreen, let's kick it back to you.
Yeah, I love sailing, like, you know, adaptive sailing, which is happening at Jericho. It's a program that offered by Disability Foundation. And so I have been sailing since June. I also love to fly a drone. I just bought a drone, and I got my pilot license. I need to get licensed to fly it, because I bought a little bigger drone, which is like, you know, I need to get my license to fly it. And I've been practicing my flying skills, because I suck at flying, but, like, you know, so I just kind of like go up and down and side to side for now until I get better. And yeah, that's what I do.
Oh, that's so great. Yeah. Watch out for Noreen's drone flying around Vancouver. Georgina, how do you find outer peace?
Hand cycling. So I have go out every weekend that the weather cooperates, and kind of enjoy the space that we have here out in Coquitlam, which is near kind of rivers and trails. And so that's one of my other passions, as well as just spending time with my nephews and introducing them to the great outdoors here. And so we spend a lot of time again kind of doing walks and trail hikes, if you will, and introducing them to different things around this neighborhood. So those are two things that keep me busy for sure.
Amazing. Yeah. It's is it hand cycling weather right now, or is it too hot lately?
Too hot in this.
Yeah. No,
I had to give it up just shortly.
A couple more degrees lower and we'll be in business. Yeah.
For sure.
So good. I'm curious if Noreen's my next question will be involving the drone as well, but I'm curious, kind of just to round us out, any summer goals or year goals that the two of you have that you are looking forward to exploring and achieving? Noreen?
Actually, I'm looking forward to climb outdoor this summer, and I'm already communicating with Brent about that, and he suggested some dates that I can participate. And I think I can only do one, because, like, you know, the other days I can't. But so I'm waiting for Brett to kind of, like, you know, let me know if that's possible for me to climb, because I think the person that I'm gonna go with, I think he's gonna get in touch with her first, and then, like, you know, we go from there. So hopefully next week. So yeah.
Oh, good. Yeah, and for everyone, Brent is also with Canadian Adaptive Climbing, and he is on the line, so everyone keeps saying hi to him. So
yeah.
That's awesome. Georgina, what about you?
I think my summer will be enjoying the world opening up a little bit more, and being able to do some more hand cycling, and then maybe see what comes in the fall around some indoor climbing possibilities.
Yeah. Kate, do you have any goals you want to share with us?
I'm very excited to be running programs again, because it's basically been a year since we've been able to, and we've started to, like, inch our way into it. So I'm just really excited to get that going. As of right now, like, where I am in Ontario, there's actually like the gyms and stuff are still closed. So just being able to get outside, and we have been doing it, and we're continuing to do it, and hoping to make it more and more available. Is just something that I'm very excited about. And, like, I got my guiding qualifications to do adaptive programs. So I'm just very excited to be able to make that happen this year. And I don't know if I have a specific goal, but just to get more and more climbers out and explore some different areas. We were kind of limited to where we could go in previous years, but exploring new areas and stuff like that, which I'm very excited about.
Yeah, no doubt. I can second the the desire to be in person. I'm really excited to do something like this in one of our stores or outside at a Craig, something, or at a gym, something really exciting like that. So I hear you. We, our Whistler team hosted our first in-person event in so long last week. We had a women's mountain bike clinic and we had 25 women come out and totally shred it. And it just felt so good to see people in person. So I hear you. Amazing. We'll jump into a question that we've got from a guest. Alex says, hi, Georgina and Noreen, love your stories. Curious what Craig's or climbing areas do you frequent with your adaptive climbing group? So I know, Noreen, you touched on White Cliff, but curious where else you've explored and any favorites.
Outdoor, I only did two of them, like one in Squamish with Brent and also with Brent in White Cliff. That's the two areas that I've been. And I think I love White Cliff better because of the ocean, like you can see. The other one, like in Squamish, it's a smaller wall, but he was doing clinic, like women's clinic at the time. So I only participated in one day of the climb. And I think I was just there, pretty much like half day.
Nice.
Yeah. So, but yeah. It was nice and yeah, I loved it.
Brent says free and easy is the area.
Oh, great. Yeah.
For people's reference.
Yeah. Georgina, have you been to the same areas?
So it sounds like the same areas. So the space out at Squamish, that's a 10-minute walk, give or take, from the Adventure Center. And then also tried out a Craig in Maple Ridge once. And that was fun too. Yeah, different, totally different landscape off a kind of a back road where we got to gather and watch for traffic while we were still climbing. It was good.
I know, access to crags is such a funny little world, isn't it?
And I know Brent has taken at least one person, but I think a few people up the apron on the Chief. So done some multi-pitch. I think he did banana peels, so split. I don't remember the names of them. I'm bad with names, but yeah, so he's done some like cool multi-pitch with a few people. So it's pretty cool too.
Yeah, no doubt. We're very lucky to have Squamish in our backyard. We've got another question from Lori. Do you use any special adaptive equipment when you climb to feel supported? So this could be Georgina or Noreen, or maybe Kate can speak to that best, whatever's.
Well, I could start, but then maybe Kate, you can.
Kind of I was gonna say, cause you definitely use some of our good system.
So my system is the same system that everyone else would be in terms of Blair, but I have a full body harness and I also have a counterbalance system. So I'm also connected to another person through a pulley system so that we can offset some of my weight to kind of level the playing field a little bit and to give me time. So if I need to take a break, or in my case, a lot of my movement is incredibly slow, I will, you know, climb a wall once in a session while others are kind of managing to go up and down more than that. And so the counterweight system gives me that kind of chance to let me move at the pace that I'm able to move. But maybe they can help explain how that counterweight system works.
Yeah, I think that was a really good explanation. Essentially, we're just supporting some of the climber's weight to, again, give them some time. A lot of it, too, is injury prevention and things like that, like in warming up. So you're not necessarily able to, for everybody coming into the gym, some of the easier climbs aren't necessarily one that they're just zipping up. So to be able to take some weight off and progress from there, we're kind of meeting climbers where they're at. So yeah, just like not overstraining. If their whole effort is going into like staying on the wall, they're not able to learn movements, if that makes sense. So it kind of takes some of that pressure off to create a better learning environment. Yeah, even I was reading a book about from Chris Hampton and Power Company Climbing, and he has this book, and he was talking about how, like, if you need to work on your slabs and you're a V6 climber, you don't climb V6 slabs, you climb like V3 slabs. And so it's kind of that same principle that we're using there. And I just thought that was an interesting way to look at it. And then, yeah, you mentioned you also use a full body harness. So for people who may be unfamiliar, it basically just supports your upper body as well as your legs and hips like a regular harness would. There's a lot of different reasons to use it. A lot of the time it's just limited core stability to keep you upright. Sometimes, yeah, just like instabilities as far as staying straight to the wall, it can be helpful. Some people just find it's really comfortable for feeling more secure. And so, yeah, a few different reasons to use that as well.
Yeah, that was a great representation. I can visualize, so thank you. And one last question I have, Kate, which I would love to know, how can folks get involved and what does that look like from either a volunteer or a programming opportunity?
Yeah, so the best way to get involved is to find us either on social medias or through email. So if you're in BC, which I think most people are, it would be reaching out to Brent and his team. So you can find him again through our website. There's like an email form, and that's canadianadaptiveclimbing.com. Or you can reach out directly to Brent at, which is Brent@canadianadaptiveclimbing.com. If you didn't write that down right now, you can also find us on Instagram and Facebook, Canadian Adaptive Climbing. Brent just sent his email. I think I said it right. Brent@canadianadaptiveclimbing.com. In case I got that wrong. So just reaching out to us and then kind of letting us know. It usually starts with a bit of a conversation about what you're interested in. And then we can kind of let you know. For volunteers, we hoping to host more, now that we're doing more in-person programming, volunteer trainings to get people familiar with our systems, and so that their first time coming out with us isn't with people we talked about trust. It can be a little intimidating to trust people. So we want to make sure that our volunteers are really confident and competent. So to a volunteer training and then out to climb with our climbers and support them. And then as like adaptive climbers, if you're interested, or even if you have questions, a lot of the times we find that people just don't understand that they can climb, and they don't understand how it would work. Like, it doesn't make sense to them that that's something that they can do. So if you have questions about if you can climb, or like what that would look like, or I don't know, if you want to challenge us or Brent out west and see what we can do for you, you can reach out and have a conversation about it first, and then feel free to come out and try it, and we'll try and set you up.
Oh, amazing. And just to confirm, there's programming in Ontario and British Columbia are the two places.
Yeah, and there's developing interest in Alberta as well. I think Brent's gone out to do some training there. And we're interested in helping anyone out. So if you're somewhere that's not one of those provinces, let us know and we'll see if we can hook you up with some adaptive equipment and training.
Amazing, yeah. We're always excited to like share volunteer or program opportunities with our guests. So thank you so much. And I did put in the chat both the Arteryx Vancouver Instagram and the Canadian Adaptive Climbing. Always a good spot to check stories and maybe some footage from Noreen's drone when she's climbing this summer, something epic like that. And yeah, we always encourage, same with my team at Arteryx, to hear from guests what activities you want to do, how you want to get involved, what kind of conversations you want to hear from our community. So feel free to connect with me or anyone from my team at the Arteryx Vancouver Instagram. And we are all ears because the event, it's the calm before the event storm. I feel like we're back in action, and we're excited to be able to host a lot more experiences and remove a lot of those barriers to access of people getting outside. So that's definitely where my passion's rooted. So I'm excited to see where we finish 2021. I think that's all we had for questions, which gives us perfect timing because I feel like we're about 40 minutes in now. So just want to see if there's anything else that we want to follow up on or that we didn't cover.
I don't see any more questions. I'd like to thank Meg for organizing this. This is Awesome. I had a great time and I'm always happy to share stuff. And I was so happy, like, I'm just so happy to hear from Georgina and Noreen. It's always cool to hear about your experiences. So thank you so much for all three of you.
Yeah, thank you both. Anyone who attended, you'll receive the recording tomorrow. I'm going to send it to anyone who RSVP'd. And then the really exciting thing is that in August, at the end of the month, we are hosting our Terex Climbing Academy, which is hosted annually in Squamish. And this will be part of a series of Canadian climbing stories that is shared at the Academy. This recording will also be shared with a bunch of folks attending climbing sessions right in our backyard at the end of August. So it lives on, which is exciting. Amazing. Well, enjoy the rest of your evenings and thank you everyone for joining us.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.